Hi guys, today I want to discuss a stunning site in Peru called Sacsayhuaman, famed for its remarkable giant interlocking stone walls. Each stone block has a unique irregular shape. The blocks fit so tightly that a single piece of paper cannot fit in between them. The variety, skill, and precision of the stonework, combined with the rounded protrusions of the blocks, have puzzled researchers for a very long time. In this video, I'll lay out my hypothesis on how these mind-boggling walls might have been constructed. Sacsayhuaman is a breathtaking structure located on a steep hill overlooking the city of Cusco. When viewing the site, the first thing you notice is the megalithic zigzag walls that dwarf anyone standing nearby. These walls serve as retaining walls to support soil laterally. The biggest stones weigh up to 200 tons and are up to 8.5 meters tall. Each stone looks custom carved into the exact right shape, so they interlock and fit securely without mortar. The stone is not found locally and is believed to have been quarried and transported to the hilltop. What an amazing achievement! The Incans acknowledged that these structures existed long before their time. We can see the real Inca work, which is the smaller rubble layers on top of the megaliths. Current mainstream theory claims that the early sections of the complex were constructed around 1100. However, there is no factual evidence on who built the megalithic walls, let alone when and how were they constructed. The claim of the site being built 900 years ago is a speculation. The upper level of the site was destroyed after the Spanish conquest, as the structures were dismantled and blocks reused. The three-layered megalithic walls remained since they were simply too large to be moved. The stonework at Sacsayhuaman is so ingenious that it cannot be duplicated today. This baffling structure has withstood earthquakes and violent destructions without losing its structural integrity. How did ancient workers manage to build this? The standard explanation is that they used a guess and check method of chipping at the blocks with hand tools, then setting the stones in place to see how each fit, lifting them up, chipping and sculpting further, and so on and so forth. This explanation seems implausible when we consider the precision cuts, the sheer size and weight of the blocks, and the necessary labor involved in shaping, lifting, and hammering 100-ton blocks into irregular forms. Hand tools cannot achieve this level of accuracy, let alone the immense scale of the work. Also, without a crane, how was it possible to lift 100 and 200-ton blocks? For a society with only hand tools and no advanced engineering, building such complicated megalithic walls seems to be mission impossible. Then who had the technological ability to perform such a feat? Is it possible that it was built by an unknown advanced civilization, maybe tens of thousands of years ago? In order to better understand how the walls were constructed, we need to study the intriguing characteristics of the walls and the blocks at Sacsayhuaman. A plausible explanation of the wall's construction needs to decipher all these characteristics. Other than their giant sizes, precision cut, and irregular shapes, these blocks are bulging and evenly rounded. Why did ancient workers take the extra effort to do that? Their workload was enormous already. So why bother with carving rounded shapes? Some blocks were shaken out of their place due to earthquakes, so we can look at the surfaces in between two adjacent blocks. They're perfectly matched three-dimensionally and the adjoining surfaces are not flat. The face side of the walls is finely constructed while the opposite side is left unfinished, since it joins the filler, which contains rubble and soil, just like current-day retaining walls. Most seams between blocks appear straight, but actually have slight curvatures. How could that be? Some blocks have indent marks that look like stamped imprints, as well as mysterious knobs which we have seen at many ancient megalithic sites. Some inner corner blocks look bendable. These characteristics have me wonder, was the stone initially soft and malleable during construction? Were the blocks originally molded instead of carved from stone? The local legend speaks of a liquid derived from plants that can turn stone soft, but I haven't found any proof to such a magical liquid. If the blocks were not softened by plants, could it actually have been cast like cement or concrete? It will be easier and more efficient if the oversized blocks were cast instead of quarried and transported to the hilltop. An obvious benefit of pouring and casting concrete on site is the ability to make custom shapes, which work best as opposed to the labor-intensive job of quarrying and cutting to fit. I propose the following construction scenario in Sacsayhuaman. A sophisticated civilization mastered the techniques of creating special cement or concrete, which had a plastic state before it cures or hardens. Their construction could be similar to how we built a modern-day dry stack wall, which is the masonry wall without mortar. The major difference is that instead of choosing the ideal rocks from a pile, these ancient workers used poured concrete to create a perfect fit. After preparing the site, the base layer would have been laid out and the workers would work their way up, block by block and layer by layer. The bigger blocks and cornerstones would have been cast in molds in the exact locations they were meant to be. Smaller blocks could have been cast in molds and then placed on the wall when they were in a still firm yet pliable state, which means they kept their basic forms and have some flexibility. The interlocking L or U-shaped blocks could come from molds or have been manipulated after they were laid in position. Once the semi-soft blocks were laid out in horizontal rows and vertical layers, they would be compressed from above and pushed on the sides to get rid of any gaps and thereby ensure a tight fitting. An analogy might be squeezing Play-Doh balls together. This way, the blocks fit together like a jigsaw puzzle. The intriguing zigzag conjunction lines between blocks would have been created by setting blocks on top of lower blocks while they're still in a plastic state. From this photo, we can see the bigger block on top warped the lower blocks underneath because of its weight. The blocks that cured longer would be harder, and the ones that didn't cure as long would be softer. Thus, they ended up creating various shapes and conjunction lines as they cured together. After that, maybe some scraping or finishing work was done around the seams and on the surfaces. This practice would have created very tight organic seams and surfaces as we now see at Sacsayhuaman. Even if the blocks came from the same mold, the compression or manipulation of the blocks would make them adjust to various unique sizes. Currently, concrete used in construction shrinks as it cures and usually hardens after a day when forms or molds can be removed, though the concrete will continue to cure and reach its final strength after 28 days. There are also products like non-shrink and expanding concrete, which could expand when it cures. Quickcrete is a fast-curing concrete that sets within an hour. I think the material that these ancient builders used for the megalithic walls could possibly have been a quick-setting and expanding concrete. Only the exposed face size of the blocks could have room to expand, which would have led to their often bulging and rounded appearances. The other sides would be constrained from adjoining blocks, soil, and rubble. At the gateways, maybe a frame was used to prevent bulging into the door opening to achieve flatter surfaces. If some cast blocks expanded and drooped too much due to short curing time and gravity, then a tool could have been used to push up the droopy blocks, hence creating the rectangular stamp marks. Maybe the stamp marks at the block bottoms could be the remnants of an ancient lifting device that put the blocks into position. If the pushing and the compressing of the blocks caused certain blocks to have too much material hanging over, maybe a suction device was used to suck away the extra concrete, therefore explaining why there are these protruding knobs. The knobs could be the result of the suction. We do see the majority of the knobs at the lower portion of the blocks, where extra material would be present due to gravity. I can't say that all the knobs at Sacsayhuaman were caused by this proposed method, but it's possible that some were caused by sucking away extra dough-like concrete if the blocks were indeed cast. You might think this cast stone theory far-fetched, but wait until you hear this. In 2012, the Ministry of Culture in Peru invited a group of Russian geophysicists to perform research on Sacsayhuaman. 7 specimens of the wall blocks were sent for analysis. Using optical microscopy, macroanalysis, and X-ray fluorescence analysis, the researchers stated in their preliminary report, which I provided a link to below, regarding the block's material, we could confidently say that the process which formed them is impossible in nature. These experts believe Sacsayhuaman was built from reconstructed limestone powder from a nearby quarry, which became plastic due to an unknown technology used by the ancient builders. The geophysicist said further studies are needed from geologists. I eagerly await such future studies. Okay, so it's possible that the stone blocks at Sacsayhuaman were cast with lime-based concrete. Concrete has been used as a building material for thousands of years among different cultures. It's strong, versatile, easily accessible in most areas, free from defects and flaws unlike natural stone, and it can be cast into almost any shape. These are excellent reasons for why we use concrete as the main construction material today. My next questions are these. Since the Sacsayhuaman blocks are not one size or shape, does that mean separate molds were needed for each one? Furthermore, why didn't ancient workers use the same mold to make uniform-sized blocks? Wouldn't that have been more efficient? First of all, even with the same mold or bucket, the workers can decide whether to fill it full or not, which would create different sized blocks. Also, adjustable and extendable molds and concrete forms can be used as shown here. Since the material is flexible and plastic, once laid in position, it can settle in place and fill up the voids with the bottom layer. Workers can reshape the blocks as well. As I proposed earlier, multiple Play-Doh-like blocks can be laid in rows and layers and have pressure applied to ensure a tight fit between blocks. Even if the blocks are coming from the same mold, the compression and various foundation surfaces would make the blocks adjust to different shapes. As for why ancient workers didn't choose uniform blocks, I think it was because they were using a different building method and likely prioritized structural integrity in the seismic region. The megalithic walls at Sacsayhuaman was dry stacked without mortar. Since there is no mortar, it relies on gravity to hold the blocks together. Each block is laid with structural integrity in mind so that the heft of the blocks ties back into the wall and holds everything firmly together. Dry stack walls are self-draining, and such walls are less likely to be damaged from frost, subsidence, ground heave, or thermal movement. A well-built dry stack wall can be as strong as a mortar wall, yet at the same time is flexible enough to adapt to its environment. A better choice than a rigid mortar wall for earthquake zones. Our current-day mortar wall use uniformed blocks because mortar and masonry ties are used to bind blocks together. dry stack walls with uniform blocks without mortar, metal ties, or clamps won't have the strength or integrity of interlocking polygonal walls. To build a tall dry stack wall that survived earthquakes and destruction caused by war requires advanced engineering knowledge with a highly skilled execution. In recent years, uniform interlocking precast concrete blocks start to gain popularity, but dry stack masonry walls are still limited to low-height retaining walls even with the Lego-like interlock feature. I think that's why the walls at Sacsayhuaman didn't use uniform blocks. Also, the fact that Sacsayhuaman is not a low retaining wall make this construction feat even more impressive. Today's concrete tends to crack if not prepared well, and also control joints and expansion joints are used to control cracking. The man-made limestone material at Sacsayhuaman is of high quality and comes from an unknown formula since most blocks didn't crack. Therefore, it's evident that whoever built Sacsayhuaman has sophisticated knowledge in material science, structural engineering, and construction. Polygonal tight-fitting and uniquely shaped cyclopean walls are the hallmarks of megalithic sites in Peru, especially in the Cusco region and Machu Picchu. Were they all built by man-made stone? I don't know, but I doubt it. Researchers ought to consider doing more material analysis on such baffling sites in Machu Picchu, Ollantaytambo, Pumapunku, Tiwanaku, and similar places. This would help us obtain better insight and understanding into these magnificent structures and the civilizations associated with them. I know my hypothesis is far from mainstream, but I want to put it out there for criticism, critique, and consideration. If we want to unravel the mystery, we need to share and exchange our measured thoughts so we might get closer to the truth of these ancient sites. Okay, let's wrap it up here. Please let me know what you think about my theory. I'd love to hear from you. If you like my video, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe. I have a wide range of topics that I want to share with you. This is Curious Being. I'm Tina. Thanks for watching and see you next time.